India and the fate of princely states post-independence. This question is related to your agenda. Would Pakistan ever have formed had these been the delegates? Had these delegates been the decision makers back in 1947?
I think the formation of Pakistan as a nation was pretty inevitable. I mean, they did do a good job trying to prevent it, but that's not really something that would have changed. That being said, I definitely think if these delegates actually were there on that day, India would not have the boundaries that it does today.
This question is directed to the chair of the Paris Peace Conference, who are discussing on the agenda of the fate of Germany and territorial disputes after World War I. Would the world have seen a Second World War had the terms of Germany's future been negotiated based on the past 2 days of discussion?
Obviously, I cannot say for sure that World War II would not have taken place. However, I do believe that the possibility would be lower, as when we were forming the treaty, we ensured that all the nations felt that they were equally represented and they all had equal compensation after the loss of the war.
To the chair of Latin American Parliament, your committee's agenda was the issue of Venezuela. I believe that the president of Venezuela, Maduro, was killed. Was the committee able to investigate and conclude on who/which nation was responsible?
Okay, so what I saw in committee and as the delegates responded to when we gave this crisis to them, they all were shocked. They couldn't believe the fact that President Maduro, who was just about to have his reign of terror, he somehow got murdered and the interim president disappeared out of nowhere. They responded very well to the situation. They got to know the fact that Bolivia or the nation was responsible for this. However, Bolivia, as delegate, he refused to believe this. And though he, a couple of times he told him that yes, this is the truth, as it was provided by one of our news reporters, Al Jazeera. But yeah, I was really proud of the delegates, the way they responded and the way they investigated the situation.
To the chair of the World Peace Conference, your committee's agenda was Islamophobia and backlash in the name of religion. This question is related to that. How did the delegates respond to the banning of all Muslims in the USA? How did that work out?
Okay, so we did introduce a crisis where USA banned all Muslims. And I felt like everybody in committee, like all the delegates, acted appropriately. And everybody took the crisis very well. They all were following their foreign policy and they knew exactly how it was to be handled. In fact, like, they all had so much to say and everybody was participating so much that the special speakers this time we established like went on for like a really long time, and I thought they did a great job.
From Al Jazeera, and my question is to the chair of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Your agenda was incremental measures to battle global warming. My question is, do we now have a possible solution for climate change?
First of all, it was an achievement that every country in the committee recognized that there is something as climate change and global warming. Secondly, if these delegates ever in the future go on to become global leaders, they will bring about changes that will not only bring out solutions to global warming, but also reduce the temperature for the better.
To the chair of the Supreme Soviet of Soviet Union, your agenda was the alternatives to the dissolution of USSR. Did you see a change in the performance of first-time delegates?
First day, we saw the committee being dominated by the experienced delegates. I was informed when I landed that it was block formation, and I was like, wow. I was anticipating the same. However, my vice chair and I also contributed to lead the debate, in a fruitful direction, and by the end of the day, we could see the change. Now, when we landed second day, there was something very unexpected that happened. I saw all the first timers form a majority wherein they gave all the experienced delegates a run for their money. And I'm telling you that all these experienced delegates in the committee could not vote off the votes, and it became so difficult for the vice chair and me to decide upon who the best delegate is, because there was no complete delegate. There was no one who was driving the agenda, who was controlling the council, who was leading by an example. But then we had to select one of them. However, I would happily walk home with the feeling that my first time has killed it in the council. I'm so proud of
him. Anisha from Al Jazeera. My question is to the chair of Lok Sabha. With the agenda of the Ayodhya dispute, had these delegates been the decision makers back in 1992, what do you think would have been the fate of Ayodhya today?
First of all, I'm so grateful to be the chair of this committee. I think more than what the delegates learned, I learned in the past 2 days. With that being said, yes, I do think that the Ayodhya dispute would have gone in such a different path if these delegates were there. They discussed this topic so effectively, so efficiently, with an intensity that could not be matched even in the actual Lok Sabha. I have no doubt that if these delegates would have been there, then so many, the deaths would have been so much less compared to what they were. I think they would have been the better option for the actual Lok Sabha. Thank you.
Reporter Namya from BBC World News. Getting back to the chair of the Constituent Assembly of India, how did the delegates go about integrating different princely states into independent India?
Now, the matter of princely states is actually one of the most interesting parts of our committee as a whole, because unlike the individual representatives from inside India, each of these is officially a ruler in their own power, which is making decisions for their own state and have their own policies. Now, I think most of us know what happened in the actual history books, and we all obviously also know what's happening right now with Article 370 in Kashmir. That being said, I do believe that the princely states were, they were appeased, maybe a bit more in some places, a bit less in some. It's possible they could have asked for more, it's possible they could have been given more, but overall I do believe that there was a lot more peace between the princely states and the rest of the Indian Union. So, well done, committee.
Question to the chair of Paris Peace Conference. Do you believe that the delegate of UK, amongst others, prioritize world peace over Western interests?
To a certain extent, the delegate of UK did put other nations who suffered from the war above their own, but at the same time, it also put its country first so that it doesn't suffer a loss. Similarly, all the other nations also thought of all the countries that were affected from the war and ensure that there was equal distribution of ammunition and money from the central powers to the allied powers and all other nations that were affected.
This is reporter Sachi from BBC World News, and this question is directed to the chairperson of Latin American Parliament. How did the delegates define the fate of present-day Venezuela without their president?
So after the crisis happened, we have killed off the president of Venezuela and the interim president went MIA. The delegates or the Latin American Parliament as a whole, they decided that they would step in and won't let USA take power and be the supreme nation that it calls itself. The Latin American Parliament as a whole here, they were very listening, they were all listening to each other, they were aware of each other's policies, each other's stand. And they all stood together to solve one of their nations, a crisis in one of their nations, and I'm just very proud of them.
To the chair of World Peace conference. Will these delegates, as future leaders, be able to eliminate Islamophobia from the world?
Okay, so obviously with our current agenda, and especially like considering their foreign policies and the crises that we came up with, obviously like they had to stick to their foreign policy, or they couldn't give in to the fact that they all want to eradicate Islamophobia. But the other countries, and especially before the crisis, the conviction with which they were talking and how, like, the emotions that they brought about and how they feel about the entire thing, yes, I feel like at least the countries whose foreign policy aligned with that would definitely put in a lot more effort. And especially my delegates, like, as future leaders, I feel like it would have been, we'd be at a much better position than we are at right now.
My question to the chair of UNSCC, were you happy with the level of research? Like, the delegates actually understand the core problems and the challenges associated?
The delegates of FCC were very, very well researched. They were drawing graphs, they were drawing pie charts on the board to explain it to the entire committee how pollution works. And honestly, I haven't seen those graphs in my life. They were so well researched. They went out to find companies and brands that are making shoes out of sea waste. And that was quite frankly very impressive.
Now to the chair of the Soviet Union, how was your experience in marking the delegates, and was it an easy choice to make?
Well, marking delegates, it was definitely one of the most toughest committees that I've chaired. It was definitely, there was some amount of competition that was there, but then I would have very much appreciated if my committee was a little more aware, just a little more aware about how the Soviet Union operated back in the day. The course of the debate took drastic turns, in fact, very, very interesting turns, wherein the vice chair and the chair, both of them, had to step in and guest delegate and drive the agenda, clear out a few things. It was not a failed committee, for so to say, but then a few points could have been better. Let's just say I walk home a happy man, a happy person, just because it was a successful committee and everyone had a good chance of participation and everyone walked back.
To the chair of Lok Sabha, in your opinion, did the ruling party
and
opposition leave behind their differences and issue an effective directive for the Pakistani entrenchment crisis situation?
Yeah, so we had a crisis in which Pakistan crossed the border at Kashmir and not here, and you know, considering the current political scenario, it's so relevant. You know, Kashmir is such a tough issue to make decisions on. I think George Bush once said that Kashmir is the most dangerous place in the world. And these delegates, despite that, discussed that situation so well. They were well aware of the time, they were well aware of the grave situation that it was, that people were being killed and that we needed to save lives. And if that wasn't amazing enough, what absolutely blew my mind was that the final decision was unanimous. I have studied some politics in the past, and I haven't seen a lot of unanimous decisions in the Lok Sabha on such a critical issue. So to answer your question, I think these delegates will do so well as the future of India.
Thank you.